or rather, the only turn-based strategy game I've played in my childhood. This game is a lot of fun. We're going to do things just a little bit different. I'm not going to be doing a campaign. I'm not going to be doing a standard game. I'm going to be playing all four factions here, and you'll see why in just a minute. Of course, you can't do a network mode or direct connect, so we're going to have to do a hot seat on this one. Players. Yeah, there's two types of difficulties here. There's the game difficulty, which affects your resources, and then there's your opponent difficulty. This is morally for computer-based opponents, so we're just going to leave everything at the normal. Two versions of this game were released. There was the old-school CD-ROM version, which had maps from Squirrel Lake on up. This game was re-released with a map editor and more maps from Arabian Nights on down. So where am I going to go today? I'm going to choose a large map. Medium maps are nice and everything here. You know what? We're going to choose one of the older ones. This one, so with everything said. Oh yeah, one more thing about difficulty rating, 90%. Like I said before, it's all based on the difficulties up here. Oh, can't ignore the King of the Hill option. This is only if you're playing with the AI, which means that the other three are going to gang up on you. As you can see, this is the Warlock. Most expensive units in the game. And to an extent, the most powerful. Now, I made a complete review of this, and I will post a link. I'm gonna turn this down to 3. There we go. I'm gonna leave it there. Alright, so. Whoa! Went a little fast there for a RC. Alright, we're gonna go a little bit slower. Okay, not that slow. As you can see, I went over that treasure chest, got experience out of it, and my power goes up by 1. The only two ways to gain experience is by beating enemies, slash heroes, and killing creatures. I'm gonna send the turn, and here's the knight's turn. They are the cheapest units in the game, but not necessarily the weakest. You notice I built the well instead of a archery range because archers are easy targets. Well, actually, all the shooters are, but I'll get to that later on. Anyways, as you notice, I went to no for the experience and I leveled up twice. I'll just leave autosave on, heck with it. End of turn. And now we come to the sorceresses. The other spellcaster in this game. Slightly cheaper than the warlocks, but a little more expensive than the barbarians. Finally, the barbarians. Probably the strongest units in the game because they start with 2 attack, whereas the knights start off with 2 defense. Now, what's interesting is that's only applies to the barbarians, and to a lesser extent, the sorcerers, is that there's a way you can get to the pyramids pretty quickly. Now, what's interesting is that you can choose between either the Stika, which gives you the orcs. Shooters, but they're not as strong, or wolves. They're a little bit faster, but they're a little bit pricier. And a little stronger to boot. I'll be getting a stronger shooter at some point. But for the sake of this stream, I'm gonna go for the wolves, guys. I'm not particularly fond of the orcs. this is what I was alluding to earlier, two of attack skill, whereas the knights have two defense. And I believe the sorcerers have three knowledge, and the warlocks have three spell powers. So let's move on. And if two heroes cross paths, I'm gonna let the computer fight for me. Other than that, regular combat rules. Speaking of which, it's our first battle. Yeah, that's the one thing about the Griffins is that they have unlimited retaliation. So if you have a lot of Griffins, well, your opponents are in real trouble. Of course, I'm gonna head back to my town real quick. Yep, I was right. It is three knowledge for the sorceresses. Oh yeah, I forgot to mention the abilities that each of these heroes have. Barbarians can travel through any terrain without penalty. Knights start off with an extra morale. Warlocks can see further, and sorceresses have bonus movement at sea. The reason why I left my centaurs at home, and I'll show you in just a second. Right, first obelisk. And like I said, I made a complete review of this, so if you guys are interested, I'm going to be posting a link to each video, to this video in particular. So it looks like the sorceress is pretty much boxed in until next week. I'll show you why these shooters are the most valued targets. Yeah, unfortunately, I had to lose all my orcs just to make room. Kind of funny they ignored the goblins. Four archers, is that it? Uh-oh. This is not gonna bode well. I mean, if my dwarf survived this battle, I'd be very surprised. But for what they're worth, your dwarves are pretty strong. Sprites either. And I'm just gonna say for the record that if anybody were to lose to these low-level creatures, that'd be the worst general I've ever met. Now that's kind of unorthodox because usually such a high-valued location like a gold mine is very well guarded, and for it to be like that really seems out of place. Example of that. Yep, a little pot of gold right here. I don't think that leprechaun's gonna be coming back anytime soon for his second board. Alright, now we're gonna be facing off against the weakest units in the game, the peasants. Now let me just say for this record that if anybody loses to the peasants, you're an even worse general than worst. I'd love to see a general come back from battle, with him in very few men, his commanding officer's like, "What happened to you?" "Sir, we lost a lot of men." "To who?" "A bunch of peasants." "Oh, fair enough, here, there were plenty of, rebel armies that have actually managed to conquer, well-trained soldiers." Who exactly, I don't remember. Alright, so we're approaching the end of the first week. I'm gonna do things a little bit differently here. Instead of moving, we're just gonna play the waiting game. I know at some point I'm gonna have to start fighting these creatures, but just not right now. Bullshit, I forgot to build a stone hedge, but don't worry about it. I'd rather build a mage guild during the week, but I can worry about it. Beginning of each week, the populations increase, and you can recruit more. Let's see here. Oh. There we go. Now, this is something that doesn't happen all that often. You can, like, neutral creatures like these guys join your army. And if you have room, you should always say yes. Because if you don't, you'll have to fight them. I have to wait. It's interesting that the goblins almost look like they blend in. Like if you notice the grass in their skin. Almost makes them invisible. With an emphasis on almost. That was a little bit of a risk right there. Gotta be careful when crossing. Hit the rewind button on that. Gotta be careful when approaching artifacts. Because as you saw just a few moments ago, that little leprechaun asked me if I wanted to buy it. Yeah, case in point. If you have the gold to spare, do it. If not, don't bother. Go this one. We have to ignore the mill for now. Okay, that was a genie lamp. It was a bit pricey, but for 5 genies, and you're gonna see why they're so powerful in just a second. Well worth it. Seems like break here. Yep, I forgot to mention that every time you mix and match your units, your morale takes a hit. And if your morale takes too much damage, then it's gonna be a lot harder to win in combat. And of course, the more you mix and match, the worse your morale is. My bad, I forgot to build a tavern a couple of turns ago, which increases morale during a siege. Oh yeah, like that's real effective. Go ahead and get your troops drunk while their town is getting destroyed. Boy, that's such a weird. That's a weird concept. That's a definite must. Always accept troops from your own unit. I guess you saw the roaming goblins. They're willing to offer to join. The rest is history. Oh, wait a minute. Oh. That's right, I own an ore mine. Oh well. Now bear in mind, this is against archers. That's why the genies can take care of these guys so easily. Very careful with the peasants. Because on the map there were ghosts. And apparently it looks like the ghosts love peasants. Because the thing of it is with ghosts, every time a unit gets killed, one more ghost gets added. And considering that the peasants are the weakest, they make a fine tasty morsel for the ghosts. As you can see, I have three units here. Nomads, dwarves, and my barbarian troops. Since I'm not a fan of dwarves, we're gonna dismiss them because the nomads are more useful anyways. Two in a row. Looks like the barbarian dude's gonna have a field day beating his enemies. Thank you. like a Warlock friends are actually doing pretty good for themselves. I'm gonna like it to the sawmill, but I just don't think the troops are going to last. Here we are. 3. Actually, now we're on 4. That's a risk worth taking. I can tell right away after revealing a few pieces of the puzzle, I'm starting to get an idea of where it's at. Very powerful units. Or rather, stronger units. Adios. Powerful ranged attackers. So I'm gonna have to wait. It's kind of sucky that the red team isn't making very much progress. Well, green's not exactly in a good position either. It looks like red or blue and yellow are making really good progress. Oh yeah, can't go wrong with the wolves. And 34 wolves to boot. One of the few locales you can visit. Be based on the old fairy tale of the three goats and the troll. I don't know, take your pick. Alright, good news is I don't have any shooters, so I'm not too concerned. I believe they always go for the strongest units first, if there are no shooters. Thank you. forgot to point this out earlier. I always find this part really humorous. Oh, it looks like they're all taking a nap. I'm too lazy to get up and celebrate with my teammates. Usually by about the fourth week, the unit should be strong enough to start fighting off wandering enemies. Pretty smart when it comes to knowing where creatures are at. Like you saw just a few seconds ago, the genie and the griffin were right next to each other, and the elf knew to attack the genie. It's pretty smart. Lumbar region. Yeah. Knights are an exception to the morale rule because, like I said before, they start with an extra one morale right here. But I think I'm gonna dismiss them. But the downside is that you don't get experience. Smart, he should have gone after the goblins. But whatever. Not like I'm keeping him anyways. Once again, we're going to avoid the ghosts. Not until I have some very powerful units, because a pack of ghosts, even a few of them, are still dangerous. Come to us. This tactic is extremely useful if you have powerful shooters.
Ah.
That's weird. There's a thing of Mercury right there, and yet can't get to it. Now, this is something that doesn't happen all that often. Sometimes whenever a new month begins, it'll favor a creature, and then what that does, it doubles the population of said creature. In this case, elves are getting the population increase. Lucky them. See player rankings. Certain creatures require certain resources, and in the case of the Cyclopses, you're going to need not just gold, but crystal as well, and that's quite a bit of upkeep. I guess when I said elf population doubled, I guess they weren't getting. God, that's a lot of elves. Hey, join us. That is a little unusual. Ah. Now we're gonna show Hero vs. Hero. Like I said, I'm gonna let the computer take care of this. So he's got the stronger unit. I gotta admit, that's really funny. Watching the gargoyles fly backwards. Looks like the warlocks had the stronger units. And every time we defeat a hero, you get an extra 500. To the victor goes the spoils. And green has been eliminated. Shucky darns. But, because there are no defenders in Greenstown, or rather, Bluestown, they are vulnerable to attack. And those are out of the cathedral. So now we got the knight's strongest units, the paladins. Smart, they just run. Now, the attackers gain a catapult, and once a turn, they launch the catapult and destroy a section of the wall. Not to mention, the castles have a garrison. Drama's only flyers can leave the castle at their own will. Warlocks are pretty much SOL. But the one downside is that if a town has already purchased the units from capture, it does you no good. Thank you. I don't know who the real winner is. Just down to yellow and red. Whether I beat this map or not doesn't make a difference. Sorry, no mats, you have to go. Thank you. barbarians are getting close to conquering.
Thank you.
can walk. Alright. Oh, tough luck, knights. Recruiting new heroes is because it's really risky at this point in the game. Because by this point, your opponents are going to be a lot stronger than you are, and they're going to have a better army here. So I'm very hesitant to recruit new heroes. We're supposed to do it early on. That is the end of the game. So basically, this game, all you have to do is just defeat all your opponents. Which means, not bad. And since my score was high enough, we're gonna enter the Hall of Fame. And this is for a standard game, of course. Whether you're playing with the AI or you're playing with friends, it all goes to the same scoreboard. In second place, which is not bad. And that is pretty much it for Heroes of Might and Magic. Thank you everybody for watching. I will see everyone next time.